This video is going to take you through chapter 11, which is about how genes get regulated, which is kind of a way of saying how do you turn a gene on or off. A lot of what we know about gene regulation comes from the study of clones. And so the first thing that you have is just define a clone. So again, pause it if I go too fast through here, because I will go pretty fast through here so you can get what you need. We first cloned a mammal back in the 1990s when we cloned Dolly the sheep. We have been able to clone lots of other animals since that point. It's even possible for you now to, like if your beloved dog just died, you can clone your dog if you want to. That is something that you can pay like 10 grand to have somebody do for you. But a clone, and the way that people tend to think about it is, it's an exact genetic copy of an organism that already existed. What you have to understand about a clone is, just because it has the same DNA, it doesn't mean it's the same animal. Because what you need to remember is nature versus nurture. A lot of who you are because of the experience that you've had during the course of your life. And that applies to any animal, not just human beings. And so you won't necessarily behave the same way, even if you do have a clone. Now, coming back to the point of this chapter, what we have learned from clones is that while we can give you all the same genetic information, we can't make you express that information in the exact same way. So essentially, they don't regulate their genes the same way that an organism that is born naturally happens to do. They tend to overregulate some of their things and then dysregulate some of their genes. And so as a result, they tend to die early just because their genes aren't regulated very well. I have a little video of the first animal that was cloned. Here you go.
Typically, we think of sheep as followers, but then along came Dolly. This little lamb led the way to an enormous breakthrough in the science of cloning. In normal sexual reproduction, genetic information from chromosomes contributed by each parent combines to form a fertilized egg. The blue packets of information on the left represent chromosomes with genes from a male, on the right, a female. When the chromosomes combine in the center, the cell begins to divide and construct a unique individual. Cloning creates exact genetic reproductions of a single animal. Dolly was the first mammal ever cloned. In 1996, scientists produced her using a single cell from an adult sheep. Most scientists used to believe that using a cell from an adult animal to create a copy would be impossible. As cells age, they specialize, becoming a particular type of cell, like a skin cell or a nerve cell. Instructions for creating other types of cells are switched off. Dolly proved them wrong. Dolly's creators collected cells from an adult sheep and starved them of certain nutrients. The process essentially backed up the cell's development. Losing their specialized instructions, the cells were able to begin fresh, dividing and specializing to produce a new individual. One cell went on to become Dolly. Other cloning techniques have been developed. One designed to make herds of cows takes place in a lab that's kept as hot as a cow's womb, 110 degrees Fahrenheit. Using a microscope and specialized equipment, scientists remove the nucleus of an egg cell, leaving the egg with no...
I'm going to pause that for just a second. So the nucleus starts here and it comes all the way down here. One of the terms that's going to come up in this chapter is nuclear transplantation. So I wanted to pause this to kind of show you. You know what a heart transplant is, for example. So somebody's heart went kaput on them and we give them a new heart. You can do the same thing with organelles in a cell. So nuclear transplantation means they take the nucleus out of one cell and they put it into another. And that's exactly what they're doing in this video. That's the nucleus that has just been sucked out of that cell.
Genetic direction. Then, they added the DNA from the cow they wish to clone. New instructions and a jolt of electricity jumpstart cell division. The clone cell is then implanted into the womb of a surrogate cow, where it will develop. Still, in this experiment, only 1 in 95 engineered pregnancies produced a calf. So why go to all the trouble? To preserve life's infinite variety is one answer.
That's where I'll stop that one, because the video starts to get a little dated at that point, so I'll skip the rest of them. So, next up in your notes, you have define gene expression. Essentially, what this means is if you're expressing a gene, it's being transcribed into messenger RNA, and it's being translated into protein. That was the whole basis of chapter 10 that you guys were already tested over. So any of those genes that were being transcribed and translated, you were expressing the protein of that gene, so you were cooking the recipe using the analogy that I gave you guys a little bit earlier. Then there's going to be some anatomy stuff that relates to this in terms of a gene. So most of the time, a gene is going to have an operator and a promoter. For bacterial cells, I'm going to be specific here. The promoter is the place where RNA polymerase can attach to it so that RNA polymerase can then carry out transcription and then make a copy of this gene that can go find a ribosome that we can cook it. So the promoter is just the place where the enzyme can actually bind. Now, bacteria also have an operator. The operator is essentially the switch part that allows us to turn on or off the transcription of this set of genes. So here in this scenario, this repressor is attached to the operator. So if RNA polymerase wanted to come down here, essentially what happens is it hits a stop sign and then it can't keep going to read all of these genes at the end. And so because the repressor is attached to the operator, this gene is turned off and we're not making the proteins that were specified by it. All those things that we just talked about make up what's known as an operon. There's different anatomies to operons. So this one's showing you an operator, excuse me, and then a promoter and then another operator. This just still makes the promoter unavailable so that RNA polymerase can't come through there and read that. And so this whole thing is an operon that allows us to control the regulation of these genes. Now you guys are labeling the parts on this picture that aren't already on there, so like repressor protein, lactose absent present, that this is lactose, and as you guys are labeling that, I'll give you the story. So E. coli is a bacterial species that lives in your large intestine. If you have had milk recently, that means the E. coli that lives in your large intestine has had milk. And so what happens is they turn all of these genes on that allow them to make enzymes so that they can digest the lactose in milk and then use that as an energy source. However, they don't want to make that enzyme if there's no milk available. It costs energy for any cell to make any enzyme, and so why make it if you're not going to use it? So if you have not had milk recently, that means the E. coli in your gut aren't getting any milk, so they're going to actually turn off this gene and stop making those enzymes because there's no point to making them if the lactose isn't available. And so this operon allows them to regulate their metabolism based on what's available to them, based on what you have been eating in your diet. Now, next up, all of the cells in your body all have the same 46 chromosomes in them, barring some slight mutational differences that tend to accumulate, but they all look very different. Like this one showing, this is skeletal muscle, these are pancreatic cells, alpha cells, beta cells, these are blood cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, this one happens to be a neutrophil. All of these cells all have the same genetic information, and yet look how very different they look when you put them under a microscope. All of these cells came from something called a stem cell when you were developing embryonically, and a stem cell is a cell that can be anything it wants to be when it grows up. So a stem cell can become a muscle cell. A stem cell could become a neutrophil, but a neutrophil can't back up naturally and become a stem cell and then decide, screw it, I want to be a muscle cell at this point. And so differentiation is a forward process, and we can't go backwards under natural conditions. So differentiation is just the process that converts a stem cell to a specific kind of cell, like a muscle cell. Now, that operon stuff that we discussed earlier, humans don't work that way. And so we have different mechanisms for regulating which of our genes are being expressed and which ones aren't. And one of those mechanisms has to do with how we package DNA inside of our cells. The example that I'll give you for this is, if you remember, females have two X chromosomes. Same thing works for cats. Females have two X chromosomes. Well, one of the genes that dictate what color their fur is going to be is actually located on the X chromosome. If you have a cat who is heterozygous, in this case, one of its chromosomes is telling it to make black fur, the other one is telling it to make orange fur. What happens is, because we have two X chromosomes, one of the X chromosomes randomly is going to be picked to pack up and be ignored for the rest of that cell's existence. When we package it up, it creates an inactive X, which is usually called a bar body. You can actually see them under a microscope, bar bodies. But that means that this gene has been turned off. So the cell that does this is now going to be making orange fur. So any place where this cat has orange fur, this is what happened inside of that cell. All because we packed the DNA up and now we can't express that gene. These cells, on the other hand, randomly packed up the opposite X chromosome, and so they're expressing the black fur. So any place where this cat has black fur, that's because they silenced the orange chromosome. So there's a question that gets asked periodically, which is, what's the sex of any tortoise hair or calico, whichever one you want to call this cat? If you have a cat that looks like this, then that means they have to be female, because males don't get to X chromosomes, and so they don't do this sort of thing. Only the females package up the X chromosome. Now, for the other, the autosomes that you guys have inside of your cells, the same thing works. Like, you can package up one of your chromosome 1s and one of your chromosome 2s, and so some of your expression gets regulated just by packaging up one of the chromosomes and ignoring it inside the cell. The most important point that your cells have for regulating whether or not a gene's being activated or not is actually transcription. If you transcribe it, it's probably going to be translated. You're probably going to make the protein. But if you do not transcribe it, none of these other steps happen, so you don't make the end product. So transcription is the most important control point. All right, so this one I stopped the video for earlier so you could see it. So nuclear transplantation means you take the nucleus out of one cell, you put it in another. So there is this process that made the news a couple of years ago where you can make a three-parent baby. This has to do with some of the DNA that's present in other organelles. I don't know how much you guys remember from the cell chapter, but remember that mitochondria and chloroplasts both have their own DNA. Well, we don't have chloroplasts as humans, but we do have mitochondria. There are diseases that are inherited in mitochondria, and the mitochondria tend to be maternally inherited, which means if your mom has crap mitochondria, you're gonna get her crap mitochondria because dad doesn't contribute mitochondria to this. Well, if mom's disease is bad enough, what we can do is we can take the nucleus out of her cell and then put it into a healthy woman's egg where her mitochondria are just fine. So now you have the 23 chromosomes from your biological mom, you have good mitochondria from a donor mom, and then you get dad's 23 chromosomes into the nucleus as well. So you have three parents. Two that are your biological parents that gave you nuclear DNA, and then one that's kind of still a biological parent, but she gave you mitochondrial DNA. And this process is possible through nuclear transplantation. Now, reproductive cloning is what they did with Dolly. Whenever you make a reproductive clone, you make a clone of a whole organism so that you have a whole organism. It is currently illegal in almost all countries to clone human beings, but again, if you have enough money, you can clone a horse or a cow or a cat or a dog. It's just illegal to clone human beings at this point. I kind of mentioned earlier, so this cat is a clone of this cat. Notice they don't look exactly the same, and that's because they're not expressing their genes the same way. So remember, when their fur color is determined on that X chromosome, they randomly decide which cells are going to show one color versus the other. And that's, since it's a randomized process, it means your offspring, even if they're an exact genetic copy of you, they're not going to look the same because they don't express those genes the same way. All right, embryonic stem cells. These are those baby cells that can be anything they want to be when they grow up. They go through differentiation to become specific kinds of cells later on. Therapeutic cloning uses embryonic stem cells, although we can also use adult stem cells that I'll come back to here in just a minute. So this is a guy who played Superman back in the 80s. His name was Christopher Reeves. He fell off a horse and he broke his neck and was paralyzed from the neck down. He was a huge proponent of therapeutic cloning. The idea here being, well, he severed his spinal cord. What if we take some stem cells and we put it in the gap in his spinal cord? Those stem cells will become nervous system cells and maybe repair that gap so that he would be able to communicate with the rest of his body again. There are countries where therapeutic cloning is a thing that does happen. We have not been able to make it work for the nervous system still at this point, but we can do therapeutic cloning for other reasons. I've had students go to Costa Rica that have MS who are trying to get some therapeutic cloning or stem cell treatment. Now, one of the other really interesting things we can do is we can grow organs using therapeutic cloning. and then insert those organs into people. So this is a urinary bladder. If you were unaware, smoking dramatically increases your risk of developing bladder cancer. And if you develop that, we have to take your bladder out, and then you just pee through a tube all day, every day. I think you could see how it might be advantageous to get a new urinary bladder so you can store urine and then pee when you want to pee. That's the use of therapeutic cloning. Now, adult stem cells. You guys still have stem cells in your body. They're just not embryonic stem cells. The difference is an embryonic stem cell can be anything it wants to be. Your adult stem cells can be a few different kinds of things, but they can't be anything they want to be. So you've got stem cells that live in your bone marrow. Well, they can still be red blood cells, white blood cells, or platelets, but they can't develop into neurons. That's just an entirely different cell line that they just can't back up into. So adult stem cells can be used to treat a bunch of diseases, but they're not as plastic as the embryonic stem cells. They can't be anything they want to be. All right, the last little blurb of this chapter is going to be about when gene regulation goes wrong in your body. We've already talked a little bit about cancer before, but one of the main problems with cancer is you're not regulating your genes correctly, and so you're making growth factors more than you're supposed to, or you're not hitting some of your protein suppressors, your tumor suppressor proteins like you're supposed to, and so you're more likely to get cancer. So an oncogene is usually a growth factor gene that is supposed to be very tightly regulated. If it loses that regulation, you start to make too much of it, and cells start to carry out mitosis more than they're supposed to. So essentially an oncogene, if dysregulated, it's a tumor gene that tells you to make cells faster than you want to. Tumor suppressor genes do the exact opposite. They slow down the ability of a cell to go through mitosis, but if they're broken, the brakes are let off and cells can reproduce more often than they're supposed to. One of the most common mutations that develop in a lot of different cancers is what's known as a P53 gene mutation. That's a tumor suppressor gene. And that one leads to a lot of different cancers, colon cancers, lung cancers, a bunch of different problems can come up there. All right, so the final thing is, why does it take more than one mutation for a person to develop full-blown cancer? Well, what you have to realize here is you have a lot of body systems that are designed to maintain homeostasis. You have an immune system that can take care of any cells that are dividing more often than they're supposed to. You have an immune system that can kill cells if they're doing things they should not be doing. You also have a circulatory system that can build blood vessels or deny tissues blood vessels. And so you have to break a lot of different things in order for a tumor to actually develop. So let's say you do have one mutation. So you transform this cell, well, your immune system's going to take care of that so it doesn't actually develop into a tumor. You get another mutation. Well, now you start to grow a polyp, but just because you have a polyp, that doesn't mean it's spreading to new places. So this is a growth, but it's not cancer yet because it hasn't dislodged and basically broken what's known as the epithelial mesenchymal transition. So it's still in one place and it's not spreading yet. So again, we can take care of this, not that big a deal. But if you keep accumulating mutations, well, now not only are our cells growing too fast, but they are breaking that transition. They're not respecting the boundary. They're traveling to other places in the body where they're not supposed to go. So the more mutations you develop, the more likely your immune system and your circulatory system just can't keep things in check like it had been before. Now, if you think about all the people that you've met in the course of your life, more than likely the ones that you have met that have had cancer have been older. And that's because there are tons of things that you do all day, every day that expose you to carcinogens, which is the next word in the notes, incidentally. So cigarettes are one of those things. Excessive alcohol consumption is another thing. Sunlight, if you spend too much time in it, is a carcinogen. Processed meats have nitrates. Those are carcinogens. There's a slew of drugs and household cleaning chemicals that are carcinogens. So just living your life, you expose yourself to some of these things. And each time you hit one, you just mutate one little strain of DNA. And one mutation by itself, not a huge deal. But as you get older, you build up more and more and more mutations. Eventually, you knock out enough of your good genes that now your immune system can't keep up with the cancers that start to develop. Now, I'm not saying that a person can't get cancer when they're young. Those that get it when they're young, they usually have inherited a bad copy of a gene or multiple genes that made them more likely to get cancer when they're younger. But basically, if you get to be 60 years old or older, you've probably got some sort of cancerous growth growing someplace in you. It's just a matter of somebody trying to find it, essentially. So I'm going to post a Quizlet thing for you guys to access in there. What I'll have you guys do for the assignment for this week is, after you have completed some activity on Quizlet, do a screen grab, post the screen grab into a Word document, and then upload the Word document to show me that you have been studying the material in this chapter, and you'll get a free 100 for a quiz grade.